Hello, I'm your host, Neal Howard, here on Health Professional Radio. Thank you so much for tuning into the program today. Our guest is Dr. Jennifer Gordon. She's here to talk with us about her presentation at the North American Menopause Society's annual meeting in our ongoing series about this annual meeting that's being held this month in Philadelphia, as a matter of fact. She's here to talk about the effects of transdermal estradiol on depression. Welcome to the program, Dr. Gordon.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
Give us a little bit of background about yourself and talk about your connection with NAMS.
So I'm a researcher at the University of Regina in Saskatchewan, Canada. And my research is focused on understanding why women's risk of depression doubles to quadruples in the menopause transition, so in the years leading up to menopause. And I'm also interested in better understanding what effective treatments there are to prevent and treat depression in the menopause transition. So the work that I'm presenting at NAMS is some work that I contributed to as a postdoctoral fellow at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. And so I'm presenting it here at the conference to share the information with, you know, healthcare providers when they're treating their perimenopausal women, perimenopausal patients.
Now, I've learned quite a bit about menopause during this series. When it comes to menopausal depression, aside from the obvious, what is it about depression in menopausal women that makes it a bit more more severe in some cases?
We don't know very much, or I guess surprisingly little, about depression in the menopause transition and how it differs from kind of regular depression. It's thought that the hormonal environment of the menopause transition contributes to depressive symptoms during this time. But that's our best guess. And we don't know exactly what part of the hormonal environment is triggering symptoms and what the kind of the underlying neurobiological mechanisms are. And that's what my research is focused on, is understanding what it is exactly about the menopause transition that makes it so difficult. Women do experience hot flashes in the menopause transition, but my research suggests that it isn't just about hot flashes, that even when you control for that, and even in women who don't suffer from hot flashes, the risk of depression is still higher in those women.
Have you seen in your experience or your research any decrease in depressive symptoms due to hormone therapy?
So the presentation that I'm going to be giving at NAMS suggests that, in that study, should I go into the details of that study right now?
Sure. No problem. I just, I was wondering if, you know, sometimes hormone therapy contributes to sometimes beneficial effects, sometimes bad side effects, you know, in different treatments. But yeah, go right into your research and your findings in the study.
Okay. Well, I will say that, hot flashes are, hormone therapy is indicated for hot flashes. Mm-hmm. So it is very commonly used for the treatment of hot flashes. But as we're hearing at the NAMS conference, there isn't enough data to support its use yet as, as an antidepressant or to prevent the onset of depression, because there's been so little research on it. But there have been a few small studies suggesting that in women with depression in the menopause transition, hormone therapy can help. And the findings that I'm going to be presenting at the conference are the findings of the first randomized controlled trial looking at whether estrogen can prevent the development of depressive symptoms in the menopause transition. So in that study, 172 non-depressed, healthy women in the menopause transition were randomized to either receive an estrogen patch for 12 months or a placebo patch. And their depressive symptoms were monitored throughout. And it was found that women who received the placebo patch had more depressive symptoms and were more likely to develop significant elevations in depressive symptoms compared to women who received the estrogen patch. So the women in the placebo group, it was 32% of them developed symptoms, and in the estrogen patch, it was 17%. So there was a significant reduction in depressive symptoms in those women on the estrogen patch. It also looked like certain groups of women benefited even more than that. So particularly women in the early menopause transition, And also women experiencing multiple stressful life events, such as like caring for a loved one, a sick loved one, or bereavement or divorce, things like that. Those women benefited more in terms of their mood from the estrogen patch.
Did you find in the study that there were certain symptoms that were alleviated more than some of the other depressive symptoms based on the non-placebo tested women?
That's actually a good question. We have not yet broken it down to see whether it impacted different clusters of symptoms more than others. I can say, though, that we did we statistically adjusted for changes in hot flashes and did find that mood still benefited, even when you took out the sort of the beneficial effects of hormones on hot flashes. But we haven't looked at whether different clusters of symptoms improved or were better off compared to others.
You were talking about women that had more than one or even one, in some cases, these life-changing stressors, bereavement you mentioned, caring for a loved one, things of that nature. Did you take into consideration those factors in those groups of women? When it comes to bereavement, it's very hard to not grieve for someone, but did you find that maybe hormone therapy or the patch alleviated some of those symptoms based on what, the feedback from your study subjects was?
Right. So I guess the findings suggest that women who, certainly women who were, mourning the death of a loved one, it's not that they, it didn't impact them at all, but it didn't impact them as badly as if they were on the estrogen patch than compared to those women who were on the placebo patch. I'd say, so the most common stressors that women experienced were, so it was around a third of participants recently experienced either the death or serious illness of a loved one. So that was really a very common stressor. And you can imagine that because of the age of these women, they're having to deal with their parents who are elderly and aging and ill. So that was the number one stressor. Number two was financial concerns. So significant, difficulties managing the budget, which is very stressful. And the third was working long hours. So working more than 60 hours per week for over a month or so. So these seem to be very common stressors that women in this age range deal with.
Now, depression being a mental condition, even though there are, biological factors that contribute to the depression, how often in your practice and maybe in your research or your experience is counseling offered or suggested in conjunction with maybe the transdermal patch or some other type of biological therapy?
I'm actually a clinical psychologist by training, so I know a lot about cognitive behavioral therapy and mindfulness-based stress reduction, for example, as being, options for treating or preventing depression. But I don't know that a lot of, family physicians are aware that, these behavioral interventions can actually be as effective as pharmacological interventions like antidepressants. Now, in this population and perimenopausal women, where there is a belief that it's a hormonal trigger that is playing a role in impacting their mood, I think there isn't enough research that's being done on behavioral interventions for these women. So there has been a little bit of research on cognitive behavioral therapy and its efficacy in treating depression in this group of people, but I'd like to do more of that research. And so, for example, I'm hoping to do a trial on mindfulness-based stress reduction to prevent the development of depressive symptoms and possibly compare its efficacy to transdermal estradiol. So that, not that estrogen might be a good option, but potentially with that research, women would have more than just that option.
So we would potentially be getting that information at the next conference.
But yeah, hopefully. Yeah, that'd be great.
Well, I appreciate your time for coming in and talking with us in our ongoing series on the North American Menopause Society's annual meeting being held this month in Philadelphia. Thank you so much for coming in, Dr. Jennifer Gordon. Hoping to enjoy some more conversations with you in the future.
Great. Thank you very much.
You've been listening to Health Professional Radio. I'm your host, Neal Howard. Transcripts and audio of the program are available at healthprofessionalradio.com.au and also at hpr.fm. Subscribe to our podcast on iTunes, listen in, and download at SoundCloud. And be sure and visit our affiliates page when you visit us at hpr.fm and healthprofessionalradio.com.au.